And so we did this together, and we injected these constructs. And I still remember to this day, she calls me in one day and she says, so I looked at the embryos and they're covered with some kind of black dots. And I said, black dots, let me see. Let's go look. So I come out and we look through the microscope. The black dots were eyes. What she had done was the potassium channel that she injected, was the one that we later, it took years to publish the paper, but, what she had discovered is a particular bioelectrical state that tells cells to build an eye. It's remarkable because right there and then, you knew that A, bioelectricity was instructive. It was not an epiphenomenon because it controls which organs you get. B, that the whole system is modular and hierarchical because we did not tell the cells how to build an eye. So we didn't say where the stem cells go or what cells go next to what other cells or what genes should be expressed. We did none of that. We triggered a high-level subroutine that says build an eye here. So right away, that one experiment like told us all these amazing things. Then eventually, and this was the work of a grad student, Sherry Au, in my group, who took on the project, and she did a whole PhD on this, showing that the other amazing thing about it is that if you only target a few cells, what they do is they get their neighbors to help out because they can tell there's not enough of them to build an eye. You know, kind of like ants. You know, ants recruit their buddies to take on a bigger task. So that tells you that the material you're working with has these amazing properties that you don't have to micromanage. Right, it's a different kind of engineering. It's engineering, as I put it recently in a recent paper. It's engineering with agential materials because it's a material with competencies with an agenda. You don't have to control it the way you do wood and metal and things like that. So okay. So anyway. So that kind of thing. Then we had a bunch more work on left right asymmetry and showing how the cells in the body decide which side they're on based on these electrical cues. Then we discovered that in order for cells to the way they interpret these electrical cues had to do with the movement of serotonin. So long before the nervous system or the brain shows up, the body is using serotonin to interpret electrical signals. So this was really underscoring the idea that a lot of the tools, concepts, reagents, pathways, mechanisms from neuroscience really have their origin much earlier. And so this was a completely new role for serotonin, right? So serotonin is a neurotransmitter, does many interesting things, but long before your brain appears, it also controls which direction of your body, your heart, and your various other organs go to. So trying to understand in the kind of, you know, in the short term, how does electrical activity control cell behavior, but bigger picture, wow, these neural-like processes are going on in cells that are absolutely not neurons, much more, you know, much long before that. So that was kind of cool. Then I hired a postdoc named Danny Adams, who later became a faculty member and a colleague. And one of the things that she did was to pioneer the early use of voltage-sensitive dyes to read these electrical potentials. And so she discovered in the work that she did in my group, she discovered this thing we call the electric face.
And approximately what year is this now?
Oh, this is the electric face. This is probably 2008, something like that, 2007, 2008. What she had discovered was that if you look at the nascent ectoderm that later will regionalize to become face and mouth, you know, eyes and mouth and all of that, early on, before all the genes turn on that determine where all those things will go, the bioelectric pattern within that ectoderm looks like the face. It shows you where all the stuff is going to go. And then we were able to show that. And by the way, there was that eye spot, which is why the eye thing worked. And we were able to show that all kinds of birth defects that mess up the formation of face do it by inhibiting the normal bioelectric pattern, and that you could fix it. You know, you could exert repair effects that way. So that was interesting. Then we started looking at regeneration. And again, the early work was done also by Danny, and then later on by Kelly Chang, who's now a faculty member at University of Las Vegas, where what we did was we showed that tadpole tail regeneration was also bioelectrically driven. And that was our first gain of function effect in regeneration, where we were able to show that we could actually induce new regeneration. So the tail is a very complex organ. It has spinal cord, muscle, bone, vasculature, innervation, you know, peripheral innervation, skin. And so We took tadpoles that normally do not regenerate. There's a stage at which they can't regenerate their tails, and we developed a bioelectric cocktail that induces it to grow. My postdoc at the time, Kelly Chang, said, I soaked them, and I said, well, how long did you soak them for? And she said, an hour. And I thought, but that's got to be too short. There's no way an hour soak is going to do anything. And sure enough, that hour soak led to 8 days of regeneration where we don't touch it at all. And the most recent version of that work is in the frog leg, where we show that 24-hour stimulation with our cocktail induces a year and a half of leg growth, during which time we don't touch it at all. So the amazing thing there is, again, this is not micromanagement. This is not 3D printing. This is not us telling every cell where to go during this incredible year and a half long process. This is at the very earliest moment you communicate to the cells, go down the leg building path, not the scarring path, and that's it. And then you take your hands off. It's calling a subroutine. It's modularity. It's relying on the competency of the material, where you're not going to micromanage it. So that was the first time that kind of became obvious that was possible, is when she showed that an hour, just an hour stimulation of the correct bioelectrical state got the whole tail to commit to regenerate itself. So that was the beginning of our regeneration program, after which we went into limbs, and now, of course, we're trying to push into mammalian limbs. Along the way, Celia Herrera Rincon and Niroshi Murugan were other postdocs that showed leg regeneration in frog and so on. Around that time, we had another thing. I really wanted to work on cancer, and I really wanted to work on this idea that there's a bioelectric component to it, and the way you can think about it is simply that. Not why is there cancer, but why is there anything but cancer? So why do cells ever cooperate instead of being amoebas? Why do they ever cooperate? And so we know that the bioelectric signaling is the kind of cognitive glue that binds them together towards these large scale construction projects, maintaining organs and things like that. And so so we wanted to study that bioelectrically. And so I had two students, Brooke Chernet and Maria Labikin, who undertook that, and we were able to show that using this bioelectrical imaging, you can tell which cells were going to convert ahead of time. You could also convince perfectly normal cells to become metastatic melanoma just by giving them inappropriate bioelectric cues about their environment. So you can no genetic damage, no carcinogens, no oncogenes, but just the wrong bioelectric information, and they become like metastatic melanoma. And best of all, they were able to show that you can actually reverse carcinogenic stimuli, for example, human oncogenes, by appropriate bioelectric connections to their neighbors. So we had a whole set of papers showing how to control cells bioelectrically. And Juanita Matthews in my lab now is trying to take all those strategies into human cancer.
So this is 2009?
This was, the first experiments were done around 2010, 2011, something like that.
So when did this conjectural connection between bioelectricity and cancer occur to you? The field was clueless about that. It's not as if they had an opinion and said no.
Well, to be clear, the very first person who talked about this was Clarence Cohn in 1971. So Clarence Cohn in 71 wrote that he had a couple of papers in Science where he showed that resting potential of cells was an important driver of cell proliferation, and he conjectured that it might have something to do with cancer. So this idea had been floated. Nobody had ever done anything with it, tools to study this at a molecular level didn't exist until we made them. So, that idea, just that bioelectricity is important in cancer, had been around before. What I think we brought to it that was completely new is the notion of that this is also related to cognition. The idea that it's not just that it drives proliferation in cancer, that this is really involved in setting the limiting the size of the cognitive light cone, at which point cells acquire ancient, metastatic-like behavior, the way that amoebas do. That aspect of it, I think, is completely new with us. That idea that this really is about the boundaries of the self. I've never seen anybody else talk about that. So those around that same time, there's something else interesting that happened in 2009, which is that we were studying planaria. We were studying flatworms. We had shown that when you cut planaria into pieces, the way that these pieces decide how many heads they were going to have is actually related to the ability of cells to communicate with each other using gap junctions, these electrical synapses. And so we had made some two-headed worms and so on. Around 2009, I had this visiting student from BU. Her name was Larissa, and I'd asked her to recut the two-headed worms, and just in plain water, no more manipulation of any kind.
Meaning cut off the heads of them
again. Yeah. So you have a normal one-headed worm. You cut off the head and the tail. You have the middle fragment. You soak that middle fragment in a drug that blocks the cells from electrically communicating with each other, and they develop heads at both ends.
Would that drug that you soak it in be called a biological cocktail? Like, is that what you referred to earlier? It's a different biological cocktail.
It wasn't even a cocktail. It was one single chemical. It was really simple. It was just one single chemical. And all it does is block gap junctions. And so what that did was change the electric circuit properties that the cells have, and both wounds decided they had to be heads. So now you get these two-headed worms. So Larissa recuts these two-headed worms in plain water, no more manipulation, and she gets more two-headed worms. It's permanent. Once you've convinced them, now the genetics are untouched, right? No genomic editing, no transgenes, genetically identical, but the two worms are, the two-headed worms are a permanent line now. So a couple of interesting things there. One is it shows the interesting memory properties of the medium, meaning once you've brought it to a new state, it holds. It remembers the two, so it's a kind of memory. It remembers the two-headed state. Another interesting thing is that two-headed worms were first seen, well, they were first described in the early 1900s. So people had seen two, be made by other means, people had seen two-headed worms. Apparently, to my knowledge, I don't think anybody's ever written about this, nobody thought to recut them until we did it in 2009. And I think the reason is because it was considered totally obvious what would happen. I mean, their genome is normal. You cut off that second ectopic head, well, of course, it'll just go back to normal. That's what people assume. So this is another example of why thinking in these different conceptual ways is it matters. It leads to new experiments, because if you don't think about this as memory, if you're focused on the genes as driving phenotypes, then you would never, it doesn't make any sense to recut them. But if you start thinking, well, I wonder if there's a physiological memory here, then that leads you to this experiment, right? So thinking in this way leads to new experiments. And then the other thing it points out is something really interesting. So for pretty much any animal model, you can call a stock center and you can get lines of genetic mutants. So you can get flies with curly wings and mice with crooked tails and weird coat patterns and, you know, chickens with funky toes. So you can get any kind of mutant lines. In planaria, there are no mutant lines. Nobody's ever succeeded in making anything other than a normal planarian, except for our two-headed form, and that one's not genetic. And so there's a deep reason, which I didn't understand back then. In fact, I think I only really figured out what it means in the last few months. But it was striking that the only unusual planarian form, permanent planarian form out there, was the one that we had made, and that's the one that's not genetic. It's not done by the way that you would do this with any other animal.
Just a moment. Don't go anywhere. Hey, I see you inching away. Don't be like the economy. Instead, read The Economist. I thought all The Economist was something that CEOs read to stay up to date on world trends. And that's true, but that's not only true. What I found more than useful for myself, personally, is their coverage of math, physics, philosophy, and AI, especially how something is perceived by other countries and how it may impact markets. For instance, The Economist had an interview with some of the people behind DeepSeek the week DeepSeek was launched. No one else had that. Another example is The Economist has this fantastic article on the recent dark energy data, which surpasses even Scientific American's coverage, in my opinion. They also have the chart of everything. It's like the chart version of this channel. It's something which is a pleasure to scroll through and learn from. Links to all of these will be in the description, of course. Now, The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means that you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments. I am personally interested in the more scientific ones, like this one on extending life via mitochondrial transplants, which creates actually a new field of medicine, something that would make Michael Levin proud. The Economist also covers culture, finance and economics, business, international affairs, Britain, Europe, the Middle East, Africa, China, Asia, the Americas, and of course, the USA. Whether it's the latest in scientific innovation or the shifting landscape of global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage, and it goes far beyond just headlines. Look, if you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a new understanding, a deeper one, of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. I subscribe to them, and it's an investment into my, into your intellectual growth. It's one that you won't regret. As a listener of this podcast, you'll get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now let's get back to the exploration of the mysteries of our universe. Again, that's economist.com/toe.